Everybody, welcome back to the Rosewood. This is Dave Vellante for John Furrier and the whole Cube team, Cube plus NYSE Wired. This is an extension of our AI Robotics Leaders, our media week that we've been running out of Palo Alto with the NYSE Wired plus Cube community. We've taken it poolside to the Rosewood here, and I'm really excited to have Axel Lonnfors, who's the CEO of Metabob. I don't know if you've heard of Metabob. Welcome.
Thank you.
What's Metabob?
So we're an AI code analysis tool that connects graph neural networks to large language models to essentially enable large language models to take in a full legacy code base written in any of the old languages that you would name, from COBOL, VB.NET, to the modern ones like Python, and along the way with C and C++. You can dump your whole code base with millions of lines of code, and without losing any context or hallucinating with LLM, our graph neural network is essentially able to detect problematic areas in the code, as well as areas for improvement in optimization and refactoring along your code base, and helping organizations to cut their technical debt by a lot.
So using that GNN to automate the modernization of that code, which used
Correct.
To be a highly manual process.
Yes.
And one that was problematic, because let's say you're trying to, you know, migrate from COBOL.
Yeah, right.
You would have to freeze the code,
mm-hmm.
and it might have to freeze it for a long time. Meanwhile, your business is trying to run, and
right.
So what's the enabler that allows you to do that? I mean, obviously AI, but give us some color on.
Right. So we don't yet focus on migrating code from a language to another, even though theoretically with our technology, it is also possible.
Okay.
What we want to focus on is using our proprietary analysis model to flag problematic areas from basically a bird's eye view on the graph of the code, because the graph represents how different code chunks connect to each other along the code base.
I see.
Then can do an anomaly detection of like problematic areas. We can narrow down the relevant context space and then pass that information to a fine-tuned large language model that can be used to generate a more detailed description of the problem, as well as to generate a fix for the detected problem.
So just to put a finer point on it, you are converting the code ultimately, are you not? Or are you just sort of identifying the anomalies? Is it both or?
We are identifying the anomalies and we are fixing the anomalies.
Yeah, okay.
So we do generate code.
But you'll fix them in COBOL or whatever language.
Yes,
native
we
language.
Can analyze COBOL and fix them in COBOL.
Interesting. Okay, and because there are a lot of tools that will convert the code. That's
right.
Not what you're doing. Your superpower is identifying those anomalies and fixing them in an automated way.
Correct. That's what our business currently is. Our clients, they range from government agencies to Fortune 500 companies. So we really went like headfirst into the enterprise space as a young startup. And currently, when everyone is talking about like agentic AI, we're also able to act like as a control tower. So let's say that you use an agentic AI, you use it to build a larger application. It runs into a problem because it's starting to lose the context and the intent of the application and introducing some like 502 errors when you're trying to deploy it. Essentially, when that happens, we can integrate into the agentic flow that when it runs into a problem, it automatically calls an analysis from our backend. We analyze the whole repository, we come up with a list of problems, and then we match the right problem to the problem that the agentic AI is currently experiencing, helping it to overcome that problem.
And you sell to the head of application development or developers? Who do you sell to?
Yeah, we sell like, depending on how large of an organization we're working with, but it would range from head of software engineering to VP of software engineering all the way to CTO, depending on the size of the company.
Okay, and you guys, have you funded? Are you seed round?
We have raised our first round a few years ago, after which we have already become profitable for a while, as well as got funded by the National Science Foundation of the United States. And now we're just gearing up to raise a little bit more money to also work on newer integrations into the more modern space of agentic AI while continuing to serve our customers and expanding the legacy code base analysis side.
Do you feel like you have product market fit?
we're close to product market fit. We have great customers. The feedback is good. To have like product market fit, I would always, I'm a critical person. I want to have like hundreds of customers.
More maturity. Yeah, okay.
More maturity. But for a young company, we're on a good way.
So you're not scaling your go-to-market quite yet, is that right?
We're trying to scale in specific verticals, including finance, manufacturing, and
government.
Yeah. But also looking to do POCs in new verticals such as healthcare, gaming, etc. for our tool.
What's the North Star of the company? How would you describe that?
North Star is customer satisfaction with the tool. I mean, that's the only thing we care about. How much value can we provide? How much time can we save from maintaining their legacy code bases? That's what we want to provide.
Yeah, because nobody wants to do that.
Yeah, everyone wants to do that.
Axel, thanks so much for coming on theCUBE. Appreciate it.
I appreciate it.
All right, and thank you for watching. Keep it right there for more action from the Rosewood. You're watching theCUBE plus NYSE Wired. Media Week, AI and robotic leaders. We'll be right back right after this short break.